बिस्मिल्लाहिर्रहमानिर्रहीम। अस्सलामुअलैकुम वरहमतुल्लाह। दिस इज मोहम्मद माफिजुर रहमान, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर, डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ इंग्लिश, मोहम्मदपुर केंद्रीय कॉलेज, ढाका। ड्यू टू द स्प्रेडिंग ऑफ COVID-19 ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड, टेकिंग एक्चुअल क्लास इज अनफीजिबल इन दिस एपिडेमिक सिचुएशन। देयरफॉर our honorable and renowned principal professor Sayyid Jafar Ali has motivated us and by his direction and patronization as well as his logistic support, the college authority has arranged online virtual classes to help our students to continue their studies. Well, today I'm going to talk about Lord of the Flies, composed by William Golding. In my previous class, I discussed on some features about Lord of the Flies and the background of the novel, modern novel, and the biography of William Golding. Today, I'm going to discuss on some major themes of Lord of the Flies. First of all, civilization versus savagery. In this famous modern novel, Lord of the Flies, the overarching theme of Lord of the Flies is the conflict between the human impulse towards savagery and the rules of civilization, which are designed to contain and minimize it. The conflict is dramatized by the clash between Ralph, who is the protagonist of the novel Lord of the Flies, and Jack, who is the anti-hero of the novel, who respectively represent civilization. Ralph represents civilization, whereas Jack represents savagery. The differing ideologies are expressed by each boy's distinct attitudes towards authority. While Ralph uses his authority to establish rules, protect the good of the group, and enforce the moral and ethical codes of the English society the boys were raised in, Jack is interested in gaining power over the other boys to gratify his most primal impulses. When Jack assumes leadership of his own tribe, he demands the complete subservience of the other boys. Why not only serve him but worship him as an idol? Jack's hunger for power suggests that savagery doesn't resemble anarchy so much as totalitarian system of exploitation and illicit power. Golding's emphasis on the negative consequences of savagery can be read as a clear endorsement of civilization. In the early chapters of the novel, he suggests that one of the important functions of civilized society, is to prove an outlet for the savage impulses that reside inside each individual. Jack's initial desire to kill pigs to demonstrate his bravery, for example, is channeled into the hunt, which provides needed food for the entire group. As long as he lives within the rules of civilization, Jack is not a threat to the other boys. His impulses are being redirected into a productive task. Rather, it is when Jack refuses to recognize the validity of society and rejects Ralph's authority, dangerous aspects of his character truly emerge. Golding suggests that while savagery is perhaps an inescapable fact of human existence, civilization can mitigate its full expression. The rift between civilization and savagery is also communicated through the novel's major symbols. The conch shell, which is associated with Ralph, and the Lord of the Flies, which is associated with Jack. The conch shell is a powerful maker of democratic order on the island, confirming both Ralph's leadership determined by election and the power of assembly among the boys. Yet, as the conflict between Ralph and Jack deepens, the conch shell loses symbolic importance. Jack declares that the conch is meaningless as a symbol of authority and order, and its decline in importance signals the decline of civilization on the island. At the same time, the Lord of the Flies, which is an offering to the mythical beast on the island, is increasingly invested with significance as a symbol of the dominance of savagery on the island and of Jack's authority over the other boys. Here in the novel, Lord of the Flies represents the unification of the boys under Jack's rule as motivated by fear of outsiders, the beast, and those who refuses to accept Jack's authority. The destruction of the conch shell at the scene of Piggy's murder signifies the complete eradication of civilization on the island. Jack's demolition of the Lord of the Flies, he intends to use the stick as a spear signals his own descent into savagery and violence. By the final scene, savagery has completely displaced civilization as the prevailing system on the island. Another major theme we find, individualism versus community. One of the key concerns of Lord of the Flies is the role of the individual in society. Many of the problems on the island, the extinguishing of the signal fire, the lack of shelters, the mass abandonment of Ralph's camp, and the murder of Piggy stem from the boy's implicit commitment to a principle of self-interest over the principle of community. That is, fulfill their individual desires than cooperate as a coherent society. We should require that each one act for the good of the group. Accordingly, the principles of individualism and community are symbolized by Jack and Ralph. Respectively, Jack wants to have fun on the island and satisfy his bloodlust, while Ralph wants to secure the group's rescue, a goal they can achieve only by cooperating. Yet, while Ralph's vision is the most reasonable, it requires work and sacrifice on the part of the other boys, so they quickly shirk their societal duties in favor of fulfilling their individual desires. The shelter do not get built because the boys would rather flee. The signal fire is extinguished when Jack's hunters fail to tend to it on schedule. The boys' self-interestedness culminates, of course, when they decide to join Jack's tribe, a society without communal values, whose appeal is that Jack will offer them total freedom. The popularity of his tribe reflects the enormous appeal of a society based on individual freedom and self-interest. But as the reader soon learns, the freedom Jack offers his tribe is illusory. Jack implements punitive and irrational rules and restricts his boys' behavior far more than Ralph did. Golding thus suggests not only that some level of communal system is superior to and based on pure self-interest, but also that pure individual freedom is an impossible value to sustain within a group dynamic, which will always tend towards social organization. The difficult question, of course, is what individuals are willing to give up to gain the benefits of being in the group. The nature of evil is another major theme of the novel Lord of the Flies. Is evil innate within the human spirit, or is it an influence from an external source? What role do social rules and institutions play in the existence of human evil? Does the capacity for evil vary from person to person, or does it depend on the circumstances each individual faces? These questions are at the heart of Lord of the Flies, which thorough detailed depiction of the boys' different responses to this situation presents a complex articulation of humanity's potentiality for evil. It is important to note that Golding's novel rejects supernatural or religious accounts of the origin of human evil. While the boys fear the beast as an embodiment of evil, similar to the Christian concept of Satan, the novel emphasizes that this interpretation is not only mistaken but also, ironically, the motivation for the boys increasingly cruel and violent. It is their irrational fear for the beast that informs the boys' paranoia and leads to the fatal schism between Jack and Ralph and their respective followers, and this is what prevents them from recognizing and addressing their responsibility for their own impulses. Rather, as the Lord of the Flies communicates to Simon in the forest glade, the beast is an internal force present in every individual and in thus incapable of being truly defeated, that the most ethical character on the island is Simon. And Ralph is come to recognize his own capacity for evil indicates the emphasis on evil's universality among humans. Even so, the novel is not entirely pessimistic about the human capacity for good. While evil impulses may lurk in every human psyche, the intensity of these impulses and the ability to control them appear to vary from individual to individual. Through the different characters, the novel presents a continuum of evil ranging from Jack and Roger, who are eager to engage in violence and cruelty, to Ralph and Simon, who struggle to contain their brutal instincts. We may note that the characters who struggle most successfully against their evil instincts do so by appealing to ethical or social codes of behavior. For example, in this novel, Ralph and Piggy demand the return of Piggy's glasses because it is the right thing to do. Golding suggests that while evil may be present in us all, it can be successfully suppressed by the social norms that are imposed on our behavior from without or by the moral norms we decide are inherently good, which we can internalize within our wills. The ambiguous and deeply ironic conclusion of Lord of the Flies, however, calls into question society's role in shaping human evil. The naval officer who repeats Jack's rhetoric of nationalism and militarism is engaged in a bloody war that is responsible for the boys' aircraft crash on the island, that is mirrored by the civil war among the survivors. In this sense, much of the evil on the island is a result not of the boys' distance from society, but of their internalization of the norms and ideals of the society norm and idea justify and even thrive onward. Are the boys corrupted by the internal pressures of an essentially violent human nature, or have they been corrupted by the environment of where they were raised? Lord of the Flies offers no clear solution to this question, provoking readers to contemplate the complex relationship among society, morality and human nature. Man versus nature is another theme of the novel Lord of the Flies. In Lord of the Flies introduces the question of man's ideal relationship with the thrust into the completely natural environment of the island in which no human exists or have existed. The boys express different attitudes towards nature that reflect their distinct personalities and ideological learning. The boys' relationships to the natural world generally fall into one of three categories: subjugation of nature, harmony with nature, and subservience. Natural world the first category, subjugation of nature, is embodied by Jack, whose first impulse on the island is to track, hunt, and kill pigs. He seeks to impose his human will on the natural world, subjugating it to his desires. Jack's later actions, in particular setting the fire, reflect his deepening contempt for nature and demonstrate his militaristic, violent character. The second category, harmony with nature, is embodied by Simon, who finds beauty and peace in the natural environment, as exemplified by his initial retreat to the isolated forest glade. For Simon, nature is not man's enemy, but is part of the human experience. The third category, subservience to nature, is embodied by Ralph and his, the opposite position from Jack's. Unlike Simon, Ralph doesn't find peaceful harmony with the natural world. Like Jack, he understands it as an obstacle to human life on the island. But while Jack responds to the perceived conflict by acting destructively towards animals and plant life, Ralph responds by retreating from the natural world. He does not participate in hunting or in Simon's excursions to the deep wildernesses of the forest. Rather, he stays on the beach, the most humanized part of the island. As Jack's hunting expresses his violent nature to the other boys and to the reader, Ralph's desire to stay separate from the natural world emphasizes both his reluctance to attempt danger and his affinity for civilization. Dehumanization of relationship is another major theme of the novel Lord of the Flies. In Lord of the Flies, one of the effects of the boys' descent into savagery in their increasing inability to recognize each other's humanity. Throughout the novel, Golding uses imagery to imply that the boys are no longer able to distinguish between themselves and the pigs they are hunting and killing for gold, food, and sport. In chapter 4, after the first successful pig hunt, the hunters reenact the hunt. Maurice as a stand-in for the doomed pig. This episode is only a dramatization, but as the boys' collective impulse towards complete savagery grows stronger, the parallels between human and animal intensify. In chapter 7, as several of the boys are hunting the beast, they repeat the ritual with Robert as a stand-in for the pig. This time, however, they got consumed by a kind of frenzy and come close to actual killing him. In the same scene, Jack jokes that if they do not kill a pig next time, they can kill a little one in its place. How daring! The repeated substitution of boys for pig in the children's ritual games and in other conversation calls attention to the consequences of the self-gratifying behavior. Concerned only with their own base desires, the boys have become unable to see each other as more than objects, subject to their individual wills. The more pigs the boys kill, the more harm Alkin kill each other. Mistreating the pig facilitates the process of dehumanization. The early episodes in which boys are substituted for pigs, either verbally or in the hunting dance, also foreshadow the tragic events of the novel's later chapters. Notably, the murders of Simon and Piggy and the attempt on Ralph's life. Simon, a character who from the outset of the novel is associated with the natural landscape, he has an affinity for the children's fear and sadness. Piggy's name links him symbolically to the wild pigs on the island. The immediate target for Jack's violent impulses from the outset, when the other boys refuse to call him anything but Piggy, Golding establishes the character as one whose humanity is, in the eyes of the other boys, ambiguous. The murders of Simon and Piggy demonstrate the boys' complete descent into savagery. Both literally Simon and symbolically Piggy, Koyas have become distinguishable from the animals that they stalk and kill. The loss of innocence is another major theme of the novel Lord of the Flies. At the end of Lord of the Flies, Ralph weeps for the end of innocence, a lament that retroactively makes explicit one of the novel's major concerns, namely the loss of innocence. When the boys are the first deserted on the island, they behave like children, alternating between enjoying their freedom and expressing profound homesickness and fear. By the end of the novel, however, they mirror the adults of the home counties. They attack, torture, and even murder one another without hesitation or regret. The loss of the boys' innocence on the island runs parallel to and informs their descent into savagery, and it records the Bible's narrative of the fall of man from paradise. Accordingly, the island is coded in the early chapters as a kind of paradise, with idyllic scenery, fresh fruit, and glorious weather. Yet, as in the biblical Eden, the temptation towards corruption is present. The younger boys fear a snake thing. The snake thing is the earliest incarnation of the beast that eventually will provoke paranoia and division, among the group. It also explicitly recalls the snake from the Garden of Eden, the embodiment of Satan who causes Adam and Eve's fall from grace. The boys' increasing belief in the beast indicates their gradual loss of innocence and descent that culminates in tragedy. We may note that the landscape of the island itself shifts from Edenic space to a hellish one, as marked by Ralph's observation